It was us all along. We destroyed the world. Real blood magic can give you an edge. A leg up against your opponents. It's safe to assume that any mage of rank does it. The rest are quietly shut out of power, to put it bluntly.
The serpent is a creature of the earth, close to the ground. The circle is a symbol of completion and the spiritual perfection. And in this sense, the Ouroboros demonstrates a union of opposites. Heaven and earth working in harmony. The circle and the serpent are both symbols that are potent with mystical meaning, and they come together in the Ouroboros. The serpent that constantly revolves, swallowing the end of its own tail, is most commonly forms the circular or oval shape of the Ouroboros. However, sometimes the symbol is constructed of a dragon rather than a serpent that swallow one's another's tails. Hello Theragians, and welcome back to my channel. Today we are talking about the enigma behind the Ouroboros, and what other lore in the real world can bring about the story behind the Dragon Age lore. For those who are new here, this contains many spoilers of comics, of books, and of all the games in the Dragon Age universe. Regardless, I hope you enjoy the video. We see this symbol time and time again in the Dragon Age universe, and yet never seem to look upon it until the new Netflix show redeems it. So what's behind the symbolism, and what theories can implicate the destruction of the veil, the hidden rituals of immortality, and how even the magisters can use this in Tevinter? Definition. Let's start with the history of the Ouroboros. One of the oldest symbols of great antiquity is the Ouroboros. Though it first appears in ancient Egypt around 1600 BC, it's even likely to be known as older than that. It is named after the Greek Ouroboros, which means tail devourer or self devourer. The Ouroboros is a symbol of motion, continuity, and self-realization. Even though the name is Greek, the concept of the Ouroboros appears many times elsewhere in mythology. In Norse myth, Jormungandr, the giant serpent, is so large he can grasp the end of his tail in his teeth even as he hugged the planet. And in Hindu mythology, the serpent goddess Nahusha also appears as the creator of the world. It also shows in images that the serpent is surrounding the known cosmic egg. Of course, the cosmic egg is a historical, spiritual, man-made creation of the complexity of our world as a whole. Even theologians partake in this belief that we are in a cosmic egg starting at the real story of the world. The original creation of the world, or cosmos, is the first layer. The second layer is the collective story of this earth in our community. And ending it, the third layer, is what our people call our personal bubble. Our simple life of what we do, how we live, etc. And this is a great example in Dragon Age too, because we ourselves are still learning about the first layer of the cosmic egg of this universe and how it came into creation. Who actually started Thetis? Is it the Titans? Is it the Dalish belief of Mithal and Elgrinnon creating the world? Is all of that true? Or are there still elements to learn from the next upcoming game that will change the next course of ancient history in Thedas? And the writers are known to not give up the puzzle pieces of creation of the waking world and the Fade just so easily. And that's the abridged version of the cosmic egg, and of course the serpent is around this belief, but that's where we lead to the definition of the Ouroboros. The Ouroboros symbolizes the cyclical nature of time and seasons, as well as the rebirth's eternal cycle. With the snake's habit of shedding its own skin, it makes sense that this would be a symbol of rebirth and renewal. According to the Gnostics, the Ouroboros represents eternity. Meanwhile, it acts as a reminder of our material existence, but as well as an aspiration to a higher existence. With that aside, we know the history and meaning behind the Ouroboros, but what does that lead us to? So here are some conclusions as to where this symbol lingers at in Thedas. Tevinter and Old God Religion. Let's start with the simplest theory. The Ouroboros' symbol is a ritual derived from Tevinter and has been existing in use for centuries by the Magisters. The Magisters perform this typically for magical purposes, which are still unknown until we read one of the comics. In the comic Until We Sleep, there is a device that Magister Aurelian Titus uses, which is powered by the blood of those who have the blood of the great dragons. That person was former King Merrick Theron, Alistair's father. A Magrallan is known in Tevinter to be an ancient dreamer device. It's unknown whether the mages used other creatures in this device, like an actual dragon, but so far we see the clear symbol of the Ouroboros on this page of the comic. This Tevinter device could potentially make anyone a dreamer in the Fade, which is the highest class a mage can achieve in Tevinter. With Tevinter's known caste system, being Somniari was a privilege, and at times you were higher than the Archon or considered of high importance to become the Archon. It is also noteworthy, or can be theorized, that since this device is considered blood magic, there may be some sort of mind control involved in here as well. The device must be able to specifically regulate human behavior in order for him to be able to shape the souls of every human being in Thedas. Titus wants to turn all non-mages in Thedas into obedient slaves unto him so that he can rule with impunity. In addition, it was also shown in the comic that by destroying this device that somehow connected to the Fade, it connected everything around it to the Fade once it was destroyed. So, a dreamer creation device, a large connection to the Fade, the use of great dragon blood, and potentially a massive mind control pool of all the beings in Thedas. That leads us to the question, why is there an Ouroboros? The Ouroboros can also represent the idea of primordial unity related to something existing from the beginning with such a force or qualities that it can't even be extinguished. So let's look into something primordial. It's summarized that the Narrow-Medians who created Tevinter at the beginning started with Old God religion, specifically the Old God Dumat. Dumat was in charge of whispering the ideas of blood magic to the High Priest of Thalassian in -1595 ancient. So the theory is, the primordial beings are the first of the dragons in Thedas, which might be the great dragons or even before them. And thus, the Narrow-Medians harnessed the power through a Magrallan and became known as the new Somniari, the Ancient Dreamers. That would also explain the reminder of higher consciousness symbolism from the Ouroboros, that once they left the material world and came into the Fade, they knew there was not just Thedas anymore. But of course, I will add this was not the only way the Narrow-Medians entered into the Fade. Dorian says they also had orbs like the one we see in Inquisition called Somniborium. So no, not every mage did the barbaric style of Magrallan, as one might think.
That orb Corypheus carries, there are paintings in the Magisterium's archives of men holding similar orbs. They were depictions of a time long before the Magisters, the ancient dreamers perhaps. The texts called those orbs
somnivorium, vessels of dreams. Could they be the same thing?
Perhaps. The humans of ancient times took much from the elves.
Nonetheless, as we have already seen, the Tevinter Imperium borrowed many ideas from cultures already present in ancient Elvenon. And scholars believe it may have been from that source that Tevinter mages learned how to use the Fae to their own binding will through the knowledge of their elven slaves. Typical plagiarism. Ancient Elvenon. Of course, we're gonna have to talk about the ancient elven empire, specifically the ancient gods of Arlathon, the Evaneris. The Ouroboros in some cultures, though, depicts a dragon besides a serpent. Mithal is represented in dragon shape on several occasions. Lore additionally says that Mithal becomes born from the sea, which is super interesting. However, Mithal is also depicted as becoming a serpent to lure Anduul to hunt her when she became mad from hunting the Forgotten Ones. Also, the serpent could be seen as a symbol for Mithal. It fits with her role in the elven pantheon. And the snake's real-world symbolism includes many characteristics that we would readily associate with Mithal anyways, such as fertility and rebirth, she's known as the All Mother, guardianship, she's known as the protector, and vengefulness, the judging and the dark side of Mithal. And the serpent is also known as a symbol for depicting the dual nature of things, that everything has both a good and a bad side. This, I believe, applies equally well to Mithal too.
There are varied accounts of Mithal. In most stories, Mithal rights wrongs while exercising motherly kindness. Let fly your voice to Mithal, deliverer of justice, protector of sun and earth alike. Other paint her as dark, vengeful. Pray to Mithal and she would smite your enemies, leaving them in agony.
Some of the Ouroboros' art actually links to a biblical serpent as well. The biblical serpent tempts Eve to eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil in Genesis chapter 3. I also thought I would never be comparing Mithal to Lucifer, but alas, it finally happened. Serpents are usually associated with trees in mythology as well. And, of course, Mithal's Valisine is essentially a tree. We know Flemeth is Mithal's vessel, but what makes this even more bizarre is that during Inquisition, she and Morgan's child, Kieran, are confined inside a blood sketch Ouroboros. Kieran is showing Flemeth the Erythemial Wisp beneath the very item we believe is intrinsically tied to Mithal. And that's where this leads to my next theory. Immortality. I have a whole video that discusses effective immortality and the various potential processes required to achieve this feat. I'll tag it and link it into the description below for those who want to know more information, but I believe we've discovered another clue to immortality through the Ouroboros' symbolism. The Ouroboros, like the phoenix, is often interpreted as a representation of the perpetual cyclic renewal of life and infinity, the concept of eternity and the eternal return, and represents the inherently cyclical nature of life, of death, and of rebirth, thus leading to immortality. It is very close to the origin of the infinity symbol too, providing us with yet another representation of immortality, living forever. Perhaps Mithal is using Kieran in this ritual to recreate her immortality cycle after she died at the hands of her own brethren in ancient Arlathon. By using the old god's souls for her own power, she is now able to recreate the cycle of an eternal life that she had during Arlathon. And there also appears to be a reoccurring theme of using blood for the Ouroboros, which suggests that this could be related closely to blood magic rituals and the power of immortality, the power of dreaming, and possibly the power of changing the thread of Thetis. Conclusion. I'd like to add that Thetis, after the events of Trespasser, will be the representation of the Ouroboros, a perpetual cycle of life and death that is ever-changing due to Solus's plan to destroy the Veil. The Ouroboros demonstrates a union of opposites, heaven and earth working in harmony. Perhaps we are seeing the nostalgic hope that the waking world and the Fade will one day become harmonious once again. And essentially in the Netflix series, I trust that we will see a greater amount of this item and what it addresses in the lore of Dragon Age. So when Thedas is at a precipice of change, threatened to come to an end, and restart the cycle of life and death, the Ouroboros is our closest indicator to a foreshadowing of the plot of Dragon Age Dreadwolf. So I want to leave you all with one provoking question. Is Thedas' foundation really coming to an end? Thanks for watching. I am back to making content on YouTube since I'm doing better mentally. And I do have new social media, a new YouTube, and new everything really. But I would really appreciate that if you enjoyed this content, just please take the time to subscribe and follow my new accounts for updates on my Dragon Age related content. All of those links are in the description below. Again, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.